إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. Brothers and sisters in Islam, couple of weeks back I went to a place to eat, halal place inshallah, مع أهلي يعني. The person who's serving us the food, of course, he saw me dressed in this manner, not necessarily the thawb يعني. And he saw my أهل, the hijab. And he just started, "Who are you? Where are you coming from? You look like my grandfather." "I look like your grandfather?" Okay, he asked me, "Where do you come from?" "I come from Egypt." "Are you a Muslim?" I said, "Yes, I'm a Muslim." "My grandfather is a Muslim." "Your grandfather is a Muslim? What is your name?" "My name is Eric." "Eric, what is your religion?" "Catholic." "Okay, let me make sense of this without asking too many questions." I'm afraid he's going to stop and answer no more questions, so I just wanted to get to the point right away. I said, "Okay, what is the name of your grandfather?" "Medina." "Okay, where are you from?" "Mexico." "I'm not getting any word yet." "Okay, how did your grandfather become a Muslim?" "Oh, he used to be in Spain." "Now I got it." You remember, brothers, we used to have Islam in Spain? Al-Andalus, Qurtuba. Huge empire there. Eh and eh, that's what I say. Of course, with the fall of the Khilafah, 100 years back almost, when the Muslim world became weak, people started leaving and going somewhere else, migrating. And he goes and he lives in another country that is not a Muslim, and he probably is able to guard his own deen. That's good, because he's a first generation. But who pays that price? And not necessarily the first generation. not necessarily the first generation. It could be the third and fourth generation. You see, Eric is a third generation. Let me begin my khutbah by saying, I haven't started yet. When a lot of us left our homeland, and I do not mean in any way to disregard my brothers and sisters who are from here and reverted to Islam, they are included. But they did not leave it physically, they left it spiritually. We didn't know, a lot of us, the majority of us, we didn't know that there is a hukm shar'i, there is a ruling in our religion once it comes to living amongst non-Muslims. A lot of Muslims do not know this, that there is a hukm shar'i fi iqamat al-Muslim bayna zahranay al-mushrikeen. There is a religious ruling in our religion, there are verses, there are hadith that addresses the subject of a Muslim living in a non-Muslim environment. It was not neglected. It was addressed. يعني النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم الحديث في سنن أبي داود من أهل العلم من ضعف but له شواهد أخرى تقوي. Some of the experts of hadith weakened it, but there are other hadith which strengthen it and also give it legitimacy. قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنا بريء ممن يقيم بين ظهراني المشركين. أهو. I disclaim a Muslim who lives, dwells amongst the mushriks, those who associate someone in worship with Allah. نار المسلم ونار المشرك لا تتراءى. يعني imagine you're living in a place and when you cook you use fire. The mushrik should not leave your see your fire. Basically, what is meant by this hadith, it must be a separation. ولا يجامع المشرك إلا مثله. هذا لفظ آخر, حديث آخر. ففي عندك نصوص شرعية, you have text that actually talks about this, addresses the issue. عندك الآية في سورة النساء إن الذين توفاهم الملائكة ظالمي أنفسهم. Indeed, those whom the angels will come to take their souls at the time of death, فِيمَ كُنْتُمْ. At the time of death, the angels found those people in a state of transgression. They found them disobeying Allah, not committing to the deen, not committing to the religion. So the angels who arrive before the angel of death, we call them the assistants to the angel of death. اللهم ملائكة الرحمة, the angels of mercy. ملائكة العذاب, or the angels of punishment. So in this case, those are the angels of punishment. They arrive before the angel of death. And they question that person. فيما كنتم. What led you to die like this? As a disobedient. What led you to neglect your religion? Ya ikhwa, the most important thing in your lives is your deen, your Islam. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam described the conditions of believers at the times of trials and tribulations, he said sallallahu alayhi wasallam, يمر الرجل بقبر الرجل فيقول يا ليتني مكانك. A believer who's concerned about his deen because he's facing too much fitna. In the morning he's a believer, at night he's a disbeliever. He passes by the grave of another Muslim who died. He says, I wish I'm in your place. I wish I'm done like you. Not because he wants to die, because he's afraid. What is going to happen in a year from now? Am I going to stay as a Muslim, or the fitnas are going to take me? I'm going to be drifting away from Islam because of the amount. ففيما كنتم؟ What happened to you? What made you neglect your deen that you ended up dying like this? Look how those people will answer the angels. كنا قالوا كنا مستضعفين في الأرض. We were outnumbered. Were few. We were minority in living amongst majority. We couldn't do a whole lot. Will that excuse be accepted? You see how the angels will say to them, أَلَمْ تَكُنْ أَرْضُ اللَّهِ وَاسِعَةً فَتُهَاجِرُ فِيهَا. Why didn't you go? Why did you stay in that place where you wasted your deen? Why did you stick? The earth of Allah is vast, expansive. Look! Why don't you go somewhere else? Your agenda was not the deen. The deen was a secondary. طبعاً, I'm not here to address, to make it clear, الحكم الشرعي يعني. I'm not here to address the ruling regarding this issue. And I'm not asking you to leave either. Okay? Don't misunderstand me here. But those who ruled based on these texts that it is not permissible for a Muslim to stay in such an environment, they really have a reason. Number one, ilful ada. Ilful ada, yani when you live amongst mushriks, whatever they do, you get accustomed to it. Yani, بفضل الله, every Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday after Fajr here, we explain Surah Al-Baqarah now. And we're talking about Bani Israel. We know Bani Israel, the children of Israel, they were the Muslims and they used to live in Egypt. If you look at Egypt, yani the ancient Egypt, it's filled with idols, rocks, pyramids, tombs, mummies. Those people, in spite of them being Muslims, but they lived in that environment of idolatry. People who worship, bow down. For look at them, as soon as they crossed the Red Sea, يعني سبحان الله, and they seen it with your own eyes. وَإِذْ فَرَقْنَا بِكُمُ الْبَحْرَ فَأَنْجَيْنَاكُمْ وَأَغْرَقْنَا آلَ فِرْعَوْنَ وَأَنْتُمْ تَنْظُرُونَ. We split the sea before your eyes. Basically, the story, if you're not familiar with it, that when they arrived at the Red Sea, the Pharaoh broke his promise and he followed them with his army. إِنَّا لَمُدْرَكُونَ يَا مُوسَى, they're going to kill us, يَا مُوسَى. قَالَ كَلَّا, no, Allah will guide us. Allah revealed to Prophet Musa عليه السلام, cast the sea with your stick, it will split, it will turn into a bridge, they will cross. Oh, they seen this with their own eyes, that Allah, the one you cannot see in this dunya, did this for them. He did this for them. But look at the next verse. وَجَاوَزْنَا بِبَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ الْبَحْرَ. As soon as they crossed the sea, فَأَتَوْا عَلَىٰ قَوْمٍ يَعْكُفُونَ عَلَىٰ أَصْنَامٍ لَهُمْ. They saw some Bedouins in Sinai having an idol and they are praying. You know what they said? قَالُوا يَا مُوسَى, يَا مُوسَى, اجعل لنا إلها كما لهم آله. Can we please have an idol like this? But you know why? Because they are used to it. They've been seeing this throughout their lives. They seen it in Egypt. They were brought up. How many of you heard your child saying Jesus when he gets upset? There are Muslim children who say, call upon Jesus when they get upset. Say, Jeez! حتى في مسلمين يعني مش children, مسلمين مسلمين. مسلمين اللي هم grown up يعني. يقول لك Jeez. Cheese. يقول لك cheese. Cheese ازاي يا عم الحج؟ قول يا الله نادي على ربك. كل ابن الله بس إلف العادة. You become what? Accustomed to it. And that is why سبحان الله in the Quran الله سبحانه وتعالى tells you فاجتنبوا الرجس من الأوثان. Don't associate with the filth of idolatry. Whenever there is idolatry, don't associate. And this is the wisdom by why we're not supposed to attend funerals of non-Muslims. Because you go to these places and they do the tasleeb, ومش عارف إيه, oh, this and this and this. This is because you see it. The more you see it, you become used to it. I'll never forget this. This happened to me personally. I used to live in Maryland. And where I drive back and forth, a Catholic church. You know, the Catholic, they believe that Maryam is Ilah and they bow down to her and they worship her and so forth. For they have an icon, an idol of her in front of the church. For every day when I'm driving, the first day when I'm driving, I saw somebody coming in front of the idol and he's bowing down to it. I want to tell you that my heart start bumping. Bumping. You know what? The next day, the bump went down. The third day, the fourth day, after a month or two, oh, these guys are still bowing down. إلف العادة, that you get used to it. For you, you don't see it as... You know, we have... this is very interesting. We have a running stream. اللي هو يعني عزكم الله اللي هو اللي بتاع الفلث بتاع the people يعني. بسموه اللي هو الصرف الصحي. Drainage. Sewing system but open. بسموه بحر البقر عندنا في مصر. I always wondered about the people who live around this place. You know, there are people who live around this open drainage sewing system, whatever it is, they live there. I said, how? Because when you cross over the bridge going somewhere and you smell it, you're about to throw up. How those people are living there? Because the land there also is the most fertile land. If you really want to have a good harvest, own a land in this area. And you know the password here. You know what I found out? That after 3 days, you don't smell it anymore. You don't. That is why a person who smokes, he doesn't smell. He doesn't know that he affects others because he doesn't smell it. He doesn't see it. He doesn't. A person who smokes, by the way, he doesn't smell his the smell which you smell as a non-smoker. He doesn't know it because he's accustomed to it. So this is one of the reasons why. But in my humble opinion, the most important reason is the next generation. That your children can turn into another Eric. And I'm sorry, not necessarily your own children. Your own grandchildren. Because listen, it's a chain reaction. If you're committed to the deen, you pass this to your child, then your child will be committed. But if you're washy, then you're going to pass on washy to your child. 3 washy washes here. Guess what? Your child will pass only 2 washy washes to his children. Your child will teach his own children to be washy-washy. Only 2, not 3. And then the grandchild, 1. 1. And then maybe the 3rd or 4th or 5th generation, you got an Eric in your hand. That is why. That is why this matter is important. I take you to the end of this. The jurist who ruled that it is permissible for a Muslim to live in such an environment, they mention the condition. If you do not fulfill that condition, then you're going to have to go somewhere else. And by the way, I'm not talking about leaving America, okay? You could go somewhere else where this condition is fulfilled. What condition? Establishing the religion. إِقَامَةُ الدِّينِ. What do you mean by establishing the religion? Having institutions which protect the identity of your children. That would include a school, that would include a masjid, not just worship. La. A masjid, ya ikhwa, is a center where people are educated about the religion. All ages, women, children, men, everyone, all types, activities. So, we in Colorado, brothers and sisters in Islam, have to do something about this. Our institutions are maxed out, and they are not really serving the core, which is the next generation of the Ummah. We got to change this. I had a brother who approached me the other day and told me, Sheikh, my son is coming and telling me that Jesus is the Son of God, and he hears this in the school where he goes to. When are we going to have a school? I told him, Yaakhi, Crescent View, mashallah, go and... I said, no, for the future, Sheikh, he's in 9th and... Kamil Ihsan. These are halfway solutions. But the solution, inshallah, in an idea, which we talked about in the leadership level of this community and other communities. And inshallah, I will share it with you after my short break. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. Brothers and sisters in Islam, when the day of judgment is over, 50,000 years long, anxiety and fear, reckoning, the scale, the ban. One of its final scenes is called the Sirat. Sirat. What is a Sirat? A bridge thinner than a piece of hair, sharper than the edge of a sword, will be on the top of the hellfire. طيب, we're supposed to cross to make it to Jannah. Only the Muslims, by the way. لأن الكفار already. The disbelievers already in the hellfire. But see, the Muslims. حتى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم will be the first to cross. Look at this. تؤتى بالأمانة والرحم على جنبتي الصراط. الأمانة, meaning in that context, the things which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed under your trust. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put you responsible over or for, will be transformed into a hook. A hook. So you're passing, If you have betrayed that amana, you did not fulfill it, that hook will grab you. And it's automated. He can pay it off. I'm speaking as one of the people who are responsible in this ummah here in Colorado. Things got to change. You know, since they came up with these general body meetings in communities, you always come to the general body meeting. You know, general body meeting is an annual thing where the people who are running the institution, they sit and they report to the community and so forth. You always find 5, 6, 7 brothers, automated too. They are there to turn this into a turmoil. And they always ask, why did you do this? Why did you do this? Why did you do this? And we're always talking about what went wrong. We're having our general body meeting on Sunday at 10 o'clock in the morning. And don't tell me that you're not interested. You must be interested because this is the future of your children. You got to find out what is happening in the ummah at large. And I told my brothers, instead of us sitting and nagging about what we did not do, why don't we offer a solution for the ummah? The solution is a community center. Like I said, we're growing out of our institutions. Yes, we're not utilizing it 100%, I agree. But overall, on a Friday like this, we're growing out. By the grace and the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the first time, we had a meeting 2 weeks back where 99 almost percent of the leaders in Colorado of other institutions besides CMS, they came and they attended this meeting. Masjid al-Nur, Masjid al-Salam, CVA, all the other institutions. Masjid al-Ikhlas, Masjid al-Taqwa, and please forgive me, Masjid Boulder, please forgive me if I forgot. It's not intentional, but almost. Even brothers from Colorado Springs came. And we presented to them the vision. What is the vision? You probably heard me over and over again nagging about CVA not having a full gear Islamic school. But at the end of the day, CVA has to accept basically help from another government institution to support their budget. And the community is not supporting it, quite frankly. The community, they have a budget almost $1 million. Where are we going to get this budget from? To pay teachers and principal and... So what is the solution? Yes, accepting this money adds restrictions on how we run our institutions, which is understandable. We understand it. That makes sense. What is the solution? We have Al-Ihsan Academy. We started Al-Ihsan Academy, a high school project here. We need a place for it because it's going to grow. What is the solution? The solution in that community center. What is the vision here? Buying a piece of land big enough that we can develop on it. First of all, the core. Everything must circle around the masjid. But before we think about building institutions, we must think about how can we support these institutions. So our brothers in Crescent View Academy will not need help so they can run their institution the way it should be run. Al-Ihsan Academy also can run. So the first thing we're thinking about is businesses and housing. First, to support this. And I know there are a lot of logistics that I'm not expert at, but that's the vision. That's how I saw it done in Minnesota. That is how I saw it done in Texas. We have a large community here in Colorado. We can make it happen. We can make it happen. So getting the land, that's step number one. Step number two is to phase it. What do we need first? Let's say we need a school. But how are we going to run the school? Of course, there are some logistics that you should come and question the engineer and the brothers who are brainstorming this. But the idea can be done. It has been achieved before, and it can be achieved here. And it will solve the majority of the problems of the community here in Colorado, so we can protect and guard the identity of our children and grandchildren here. I invite all the brothers and the sisters who care about this ummah to come on Sunday to look into this. We're going to have a presentation, an engineer who will present the idea. Let's take your input and see what we can do with this. I want to stress that this is a community large project, not just the CMS community. CVA, Masjid al-Salam, Masjid al-Taqwa, Masjid al-Nur. All these big institutions, it will serve the ummah. Basically, you want to have a place where everyone can find a niche. If you want to go and hang around with your family, you can go there. If you want to go play soccer, you can play soccer there. If you want to play football, you can play football there. If you want to play tennis, you can play tennis there. If you want to walk around, you can walk around there. Community center. Ummah. That will help us. Again, everything begins with a dream. And we know brothers in Boulder, they dreamt of having a masjid. A lot of people were telling them, you cannot do it, you cannot do it, you cannot do it. They did it. Alhamdulillah. The brothers in Fort Collins, they broke the ground. We can do something, brothers and sisters in Islam. Finally, when I arrived here, the first Ramadan, I remember, and possibly a lot of you remember, when I looked at the parking issue and the neighbors are placing no parking zone, and I suggested buying a place around here and turn it into a parking lot. Alhamdulillah, we're able to raise $145,000. Where this money now? Still sitting. After we collected it, I invited the neighbor, prospective Yani, who is interested in selling his house. You know how much he asked? $750,000. Come on, to have 50 cars parking, $750,000, something wrong. Okay, what is the other solution? They said, let's build a multi-level parking. They said almost $2 to $3 million. Is that a solution too? We're really wasting the resources of the community if we do this. Why don't we just admit it that we have grown out, and we have to think about 20 or 25 or 30 years ahead, not just next year or next month. Al-Shahid, or the important thing, is this money, inshallah, if the donors agree to this, will be the first seed for that community project. Bi-idhnillah, it will be passed or transferred to this account if the donors, if you are a donor and you want to talk about your donation, come and speak to me. If you want it back, هذا والشرع. If you donate it to a certain project, Islamically speaking, Sharia wise, I cannot divert it. I can't. I will be a sinner then. It must go to that which you intended for it to go. You can talk to me, inshallah, if you're interested. I wanted to bring this up. I wanted to excite you about coming to that community get together on Sunday at 10 o'clock in the morning, and we'll have more details about this project and other exciting things that are happening here in Colorado, بإذن الله تعالى. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا.